Hey there, folks. Welcome to Spectrum Pulse. We talk about music, movies, art, and culture. And today we're going to be talking about the sophomore album from Brothers Osborne called Port St. Joe. Oh, I was looking forward to this one. And for a nice change of pace, it didn't look like it was just me this time around. And that's really thrilling to hear. There's some buzz behind this record. And there's really no mincing words about it. In the face of other country duos, Brothers Osborne have surged to the forefront in critical acclaim and presence over the past couple of years, ever since they released Pawn Shop in very early 2016. And what's more exciting is that they seem to be doing it all the right way. Sure, that debut album was uneven. It's had some rough patches, both in the production and songwriting. It wasn't quite a great record, but you wouldn't really know it given that Brothers Osborne have a canny eye for releasing great singles like 21 Summer, and especially It Ain't My Fault, which might just have one of the best music videos of the decade, regardless of genre. It's kick-ass. It's one of my favorite songs of 2016. It was also one of those projects where the sheer talent, wit, and swagger was hard to deny. And while the larger mainstream has never quite gone on board the way they should have, especially considering it wasn't like their label mate Eric Church had many singles in circulation to compete with them, this upcoming album's starting to get a lot of attention and critical acclaim. See how they follow up and expand their southern rock and country style while still keeping that idiosyncratic flair and firepower? That was really reassuring for me. Or, to put it another way, even though I've been a fan of these guys for a couple years now, I was really excited to see how much everybody else wanted to get on board. So alright, let's not waste any more time. What did we get on Port St. Joe? Okay, this was not what I was expecting from Brothers Osborne. See, if I were to describe what I liked about this group coming out of Pawn Shop, it would be their dramatic intensity and their firepower that gave their love songs such heft and their party tracks such fervor. It certainly wasn't their laid-back, chill, soulful side that sounds like Chris Stapleton teaming up with Toby Keith. And I don't mean that as a pejorative at all, believe it or not. That's what makes Port St. Joe such a perplexing listen, because doubling down on this looser, slightly hungover vibe, it does make for a more consistent album than Pawn Shop, don't get me wrong, but not exactly one that seems to have the brilliant high points that made their debut record so promising for me. It's definitely a very good record and a stylistic detour that will prove enjoyable to a lot of folks. I bet it does pretty well in the mainstream, but not exactly one that I feel highlights the duo's potential quite as well as it could. And I want to start off with the brothers themselves, specifically with TJ on lead vocals. I mean, I've always liked the rich warmth of his vocal timbre, but what made Pawn Shop so potent for me is that he conveyed that natural charisma across a broader stylistic range, from a bass-heavy gruffness to his more soulful baritone to his sharper, more impressive bellowing vocals. And to put it mildly, Port St. Joe does not nearly require the same range or volume out of him, which means that TJ tends to default to a smoother, husky, slightly more reserved delivery that still has deep and resonant, but doesn't quite command the mix in the same way. So thus, you would expect the production to give him the sort of space and placement to really accentuate his presence, and you'd mostly be right, but this is where we have to step into the production and deal with perennially frustrating producer Jay Joyce. And look, to Jay Joyce's credit, over the past couple of years, he's curbed a lot of the overproduction impulses that have made him so damn frustrating for me in review after review, and he knows enough to get out of the way of some truly excellent guitar work from John Osborne, both acoustic, electric, and on the mandolin, as well as punch up some of the bass lines to maintain some foundations, and even get a little bit funky on songs like Shoot Me Straight and A Couple Wrongs Making It All Right. But it's got enough tonal depth to work surprisingly well. I don't expect Jay Joyce to pull off country funk all that well in the production, but yeah, it was credible here. But it's also hard to avoid the impression that Jay Joyce's production choices are still pretty uneven. And let's start off with the vocals. Yes, when TJ gets a little bit quieter, he's got the ample space to do so. But where he does belt a little more, there's songs like Drank Like Hank, where it sounds like he's situated a little bit too deep into the mix, or back to A Couple Wrongs Making It All Right, where the vocal harmony's a shade too neat and flat to really show off more organic richness. And that's arguably the biggest inconsistency on this album. I'm not gonna deny there's a certain sharp crispness in the strumming and the picking of the guitar that cuts through, but more of that natural organic tone feels strangely absent to firm up the melody outside of swells of deeper organ and pedal steel. And even then, that can be in the background and be pretty staccato. It sounds like a lot more is focused on the strumming motion and tone itself along with the percussion. And that can feel like not always the best cushion for the vocals or even the main guitar melody. And as such, I found myself gravitating to the ballads that have a little bit more depth and body and presence, like I Don't Remember Me Before You, and the shimmering Pushing Up Daisies Love Alive, and especially the closing song While You Still Can, with a wonderfully positioned key change. It's a great low-key finish, one of the best songs here. Now granted, on the flip side, you get songs like A Little Bit Trouble, which seems to be all liquid organ and watery guitar phrases, and winds up a little bit limp as the result in some of the production, but my issues with that song run more into the content, where it's framed as the sort of slightly dangerous hookup, but not really nailing any greater element of tension, so just kind of falls flat. And yet what's fascinating is that said tension isn't really a factor in most of the rest of these songs here either, as our protagonist spends most of the album drinking and smoking himself into a finely tuned oblivion, and then staggering towards some sort of melancholic realization of pathos, from the lost memories and hangover of I Don't Remember Me Before You, to the woman as spirits metaphor of Tequila Again. It's very clear that If It Ain't My Fault was the party, this album is the morning after, it's the hangover, it's the Bloody Marys. And while songs like Drank Like Hank and Shoot Me Straight do have some of that party, there's almost a resignation coming beneath the ladder of the blackout that's coming. And songs like Weed, Whiskey, and Willie show how much of a lifeline that blackout can be for him just to get away from that deeper pain. It's also one of the reasons that the more earnest sentiments, they do resonate for me. From the unstable relationship of Pushing Up Daisies, Love Alive, that they're damn near destiny bound to hold true to the small moments blurring by so fast on While You Can. And all that being said, while there is a certain haggard self-awareness to a lot of these songs, you're not exactly getting a lot of complexity or deeper nuance of what deeper pain he might be blocking out. And while I'm not bothered by the name dropping of classic country artists, I do find myself wishing for a little bit more meat on these songs to really hit harder, especially if the intensity and the delivery has been tamped back significantly. You kind of expect the songwriting to step up to fill in the blanks, and I'm not sure it gets all the way. But regardless of that, I still think Port St. Joe is an interesting pivot for this group. Definitely more refined, a lot more consistent, but not quite an album that grabs me as much as I was hoping. And it's hard not to feel like Brothers Osborne are struggling to slip out of the lingering shadow of their influences. I mean, they definitely grew up, they got more serious on this album, but the lack of greater weight doesn't really always pay that off for them. Still, for me, solid 7 out of 10, definitely a recommendation. Hopefully a good single choice will lead to these guys continuing to rack up some mainstream success, because it's certainly worth your time, but hey, it could have been better. Beyond that though, still good. Check it out. So yeah, thanks a lot for watching. Like to like and subscribe, I'd be more than grateful. Not really a lot to say about these guys. It's a pretty good record. I was hoping for more. Bit of a weird direction they went in, but hey, if it's your speed, link to buy it's down there in the description below. And I got the poll up there for all you Brothers Osborne fans to tell me how wrong I am. Actually, you guys seem pretty straightforward and honest, so you might be on the same page. I really can't tell these days. Beyond that, if you guys want to get involved in supporting this channel, the link to my Patreon is right over there, where 3 times a week you guys get to vote on my schedule, and once a week for the higher tier contributors, you guys get to add albums, movies, or even a top 10 list to that schedule. A lot more details right over there. Keep in mind, it's now moved from a per video to a per month schedule, so it's a lot easier for you guys to get some more bang for your buck. And you want to see what's on my schedule? I post it on my Instagram, link below. But until then, I'm Mark, you're watching Spectrum Pulse, and I'll see you next time.